get through it. So my name is Amos Gutierrez, and I work as the Adobe Ambassador in the Innovation Foundry, and been here now for about, I don't know, 5 months or so. And this is a really exciting thing to be able to be a part of putting together this event and really looking to promote creativity here on campus today, particularly in our classrooms. So we're going to get started, and I'm just going to have, since we're videoing, I'm going to have everybody introduce themselves, kind of talk, tell us what you teach and kind of the roles that you have. That way those who are viewing later through the video can have a better idea of what you do. So we'll start with you, Bill.
My name's Cliff Barbarick, and I teach Bible and New Testament in the Department of Bible Missions and Ministry. And I also work here in the Adams Center as the Director of Faculty Development. And so in my classes, I try to find some ways to integrate media creation in some of those classes. It may not be the most natural fit. You might automatically think that a Bible class is where you would encounter that, but I do feel like for our majors, our students who might be going on into ministry, I think that's starting to become maybe even an essential skill for them to have in the different ministry contexts they might find themselves in. And so even though I'm not really adequate to teach them how to do that, I try to build some things in and get them some exposure and start to equip them. And then I've also found, even in classes, students who aren't majoring in Bible, to find another way to communicate ideas, another register to communicate in, is good for them and also opens the door for certain students to succeed, right, that maybe aren't succeeding as well in other things. So I like that part of it. And then here in the Adams Center, we're always looking for opportunities to be able to equip faculty to think about how to use some of these kinds of things in the classes.
So I'm Trey Shirley, I'm on day 13 of a cold, so if you can't hear me, I'll try to speak louder.
You sound very distinguished.
Oh, yeah, well, thank you. So I'm the assistant chair in the Department of Art and Design, and I teach design classes. I'm a graphic designer by trade, and then I also teach art history. And so that's half my appointment, and then the other half of my appointment is I'm the director of Cornerstone, which is our freshman seminar class, we use, of course, in graphic design, we're integrating digital tools. It's an essential, fact that our students are able to display not just competence but mastery of the Adobe suite in particular. Photoshop, InDesign, and Illustrator have been the industry standards for a long time, but that's even growing more and more where, if they have knowledge of After Effects and Premiere and other, aspects of the suite, then, that makes them much more marketable when they go on. And that's one of the things that we really desire is for our students to be able to get jobs, and they are getting jobs in it quite well. I can't take credit for that. I'm glad Neil's here because he's the one that's doing all the work in the trenches. In Cornerstone, in our freshman seminar, we also integrate, we have a major assignment at the end of the semester that's a digital essay where teachers have three options. They can either do a true digital essay that is a narrative that is told through the use of video and photos and music. And they're using Adobe Spark as well as Adobe Premiere, depending on their level of confidence. And then we also have an audio essay that's sort of a podcast assignment that's an option for faculty to, do. And so doing that. And then we also have a photo essay assignment that is another option. And so kind of depends on the instructor's skill set and desire. But by far the most popular assignment has been the digital essay, and so I'll talk about that here in a little bit.
I'm Brian Burton. I teach digital entertainment technology, which is game design, real-time CGI, special effects, green screen, all the fun stuff. the students come in to create the next generation of entertainment, whether that's VR, AR, just traditional mobile games, or cinematic pieces. We're very involved in the whole entertainment side of things.
Awesome, thank y'all. So y'all went right into the first question, which was great, talking about what kinds of digital skills and digital competencies, digital literacy that you're teaching in your classes. And you've talked a little bit about the tools that y'all use with Spark, and we'll be able to expand that a little bit more. But y'all sent some examples of some of the work that your students are doing. So I'd like to go ahead and show some of that kind of as we get started, so that we can, and then maybe just explain some of the what the assignment was and the tools that were used for it. So we're going to start with Cliff.
Okay.
Let's see.
Yeah. So this is a upper division class for majors in the Bible department. So these are all students who are Bible majors of various types. A lot of them are going into youth ministry or other forms of ministry. Some going maybe thinking about academic tracks where they're going to study the Bible and write and teach and do those kind of things. But most of them thinking about ministry context. And so it's kind of the research methods class for people within our program. How do you learn to research and study and write about the Bible? And so one of the major projects is an exegesis paper. Right, we work on throughout the semester, and they write this, you know, big essay for them, 8 to 10 pages, where they're putting together the fruits of their research that they've been doing some reading and thinking, and so they write all that up. But I've for a few years thought I'd like another output connected to that research that could help them think about some other ways that might communicate what they find through this kind of research. Because I worry if the only connection is a scholarly essay to scholarly research, then when they get in a situation where there's no longer need for scholarly essays to be written, they'll also feel there's no longer need for scholarly research to be done. And so, like, realizing, no, I can do this work and can have these other outlets that are more appropriate to the context I'm in. And so, as I've said, I really think for our students, regardless of what ministry context they're in, some familiarity with how to produce digital content, video content, would make them better at their jobs, maybe more marketable. And so I thought, all right, I want to find a way that they can take the fruit of their exegetical work and find another way to express that. One of the other things that we do is, as a class, we commit to internalize large portions of scripture and tell it out loud to one another, and we invite others to come as another way to study and the scripture and attend to it closely. And so this example it comes from a class that we as a class memorized 2 Corinthians and told it, and we actually, in fact, performed it live over in the library. But I also had them come and record a portion of what they were working on for their exegesis paper, and then integrate that with some visual exegetical asides, right? So what kind of things could you use to splice into your performance that would add some content? Because there's often subtext that's going on, or there's some background information that you can supply, and so how could you weave that in? So I've been learned a lot through doing that, crafting that assignment, working through that assignment with the students, and so we'll do it again this semester. We're in the middle of on the same thing, and have made some changes to how we've done it, and including trying to build in a little bit more robust training on some of the tools. So last time I pointed them to some resources, and we've had a couple of sessions in the library, in the learning studio, where they could have hands-on help from the staff there and putting together their videos and using some of the Adobe tools. I've given them options to use different software depending on what they're comfortable with, but this time I'm requiring them to complete the boot camp, the Premiere Pro boot camp that the learning studio has created, before we go into our workshop. And that way, even if they had zero experience, they've gone through the boot camp, and they have to, the assignment before they go into the workshop is they need to show me a screenshot of their Premiere Pro project file open with the videos loaded in there that they're going to use, right? They don't have to be in the timeline yet, they don't have to have edit anything yet, but I even know they know they've got Premiere Pro on their laptop or some of their computer. They've gone as far as having the videos loaded in there. So that was one change we made that will hopefully make the workshop time even more productive. Mm-hmm. The other thing with input from the learning studio that we learned, I wanted a two-camera shot so that they could go back and forth, and that way that could provide some editing options for them. That was a bit onerous on the learning studio and on the students. Like, I didn't realize how hard the editing became when students just add that second camera. So we moved back to just a single camera this time with their recordings, but the Learning Studio offered them some training on B-roll, which we didn't do last time. And so, kind of, what is B-roll? How can you get it? Because Talk knew that, and so he's got some things in there that they're kind of B-roll-like. And so, we gave them some training on that. I'll be interested to see, you know, what they do with that, if that helps them. And the other thing, too, we recorded those near the end of the semester, the assignments, their final exam. And so we went into the Learning Studio media area and recorded those at that time, which had been a couple weeks, 3-4 weeks maybe, since we'd actually performed it as a class. And they were a bit rusty, not surprisingly, but remembering all the verses, which is fine. That's actually, in terms of learning it, it's better to forget it and learn it again. Like, that cements it. But they didn't have the time to learn it again. And so you notice a bunch of kind of choppy cuts in Talk's performance. It's because he took a bunch of different takes, right? And then he could edit them together. But my hope was, we've already recorded the performances. The idea was, let's record your performances much closer in time when you're giving the live performance, and hopefully your takes are more
awesome.
Are better. Anyway, so
thank you.
How many students are in your class?
The class maxes out at 20. This time I think I had 10, so
okay.
I don't know how much I had.
All right, so we've got some work from some of Trey's students, and since these are links, I've already got them open.
All right,
outside of.
And if you click on the sound thing up in the top. Let's see if we have any more videos, we'll see if we can fix it while we're out. And then click on Sharp HDMI.
There we go.
It should start coming through here now.
Awesome.
I don't know, it just reset itself.
So, as I said, I teach in the Department of Art and Design, within our department is, of course, we have graphic design and interior design majors, and as well as fine arts majors. And for our graphic design majors, as I said, you know, there are things that we want to show so that when they graduate, they're marketable. And we have made a lot of decisions over the past 5 or 10 years to make sure that when students are graduating, they have a well put together portfolio that they're ready to display. As they're applying for jobs and we have some students who, you know, will send their portfolio to the first place that they send it to, and they'll hire them right away, you know, and then some who, you know, are applying at 30 different places, and they're not sure where they want to end up. But we've had really great placement. Again, I can't take any credit for this because I'm not one of the teachers in the graphic design sequence, but I get to be involved with all that's going on there. And the portfolios and the things that we're doing in there are really, really powerful. In fact, I was just looking at the numbers the other day, and our students' average salaries have grown by $20,000 average just in the last half decade for art and design graduates. And so I think that a lot of that comes back to the work that's being done in these students producing and leaving with quality products. And that comes through a number of scaffolding exercises that are sort of building upon each other, starting in the freshman year and working their way through the senior, the capstone class, which is a portfolio experience that that Neil teaches. And so it's a little intimidating to be sitting here with Neil. He should be the one that you're talking about.
Doing great, Trey.
So just correct me if I say anything. So we have a number of things that we do. We review our students every year at the end of the year on their projects. And so we're making sure that they're keeping track of those. We now require them to have a designed portfolio by the end of their junior year, we found that we used to just do the portfolio in the senior year, and they were kind of scrambling to put it together at the last minute. But if they already have one put together in the junior year, by the time they get to the senior year, then they're revising it and improving upon it instead of scrambling to get it together. And that's made drastic changes, I think. But we have link assignments as well that connect from the sophomore year through the senior year, where they'll start out designing a logo in their typography class, and then they'll use that logo in packaging, and then they'll integrate it into their projects in different courses, design a website, so they have one brand that they've developed out, and in multiple different platforms where they're designing the logo in Photoshop, they're designing the logo in Illustrator, they're doing mock-ups in Photoshop, they're designing interactive elements, and then they're publishing all this, and many of our students opt to use Adobe Portfolio to create their portfolios. So I just grabbed a couple of recent graduates. This is Kaylin Nelson. She is one of the designers at Mary Kay now, and is doing very well for herself. She was always one of our very talented students, and you can see by the quality of her work. But I just want to point out, she's integrating all these different tools where we have, things that are made in kind of very physical package designs, interactive designs, typography, and is using all these different elements. And so, for us, like, being able to display that these students not only kind of have the bare essentials in terms of the knowledge of the software, but also making sure that they're displaying some degree beyond competence is so valuable. So this is Denver Gravitt, one of our other recent graduates. Denver is now in Austin with Canalis & Co., a design firm that was actually started by one of our ACU alumni. He always had this like very distinctive, he loved sports, grew up in a big sports family, and so was able to integrate his passion into his work, and this mock-up for the Red Fox root beer is just fantastic, where he's really maximizing the potential of the tools. So this is kind of an example of students using these tools at kind of a comprehensive level, very integrated, very strategically planned from the beginning of the program, and then developed all throughout until their senior year, and so I felt like this kind of presented the full kind of gamut of what our students are doing and what they're capable of. The other thing that I wanted to talk about was the digital essay. We can go ahead and play it, and I'll just talk over. Let's play it, and then I'll talk through the assignment. We may not watch the whole thing.
Welcome to my life. A life that is sometimes seemingly average, but also full of adventure, love, and new experiences. One final search for anything we left behind, and we're off. Off to a new adventure, a new memory beginning to take shape. A time where we leave the ordinary behind and begin a new adventure. The road goes on for miles, but we don't seem to mind. Even through the uncomfortable sleeping positions, the are we there yet, and the slight moans of car sickness, the anticipation built. With every stop, the air gets crisper and brisker. The car comes to a stop. Even with my eyes closed, I know we finally made it. The doors fly open, and with my boots now wedged in the snow, I see crystals falling from the sky. White all around, and the faint smell of fresh, minty pine trees and wood burning in the distance. I stand there, admiring the forest to the north and the mountain to the south. The next morning, we get up bright and early, eat breakfast, and put on our gear. We make sure we have everything, and then we march in our gear to the ski lift. This is it, the moment we've been waiting for.
Okay,
finally back on the mountain, one of my favorite.
So this is an example of the digital essay that we do in Cornerstone. And Cornerstone is a freshman orientation class, and we have three major projects in the class. The first is an oral presentation. The second is a major research project that they do. And then the third is sort of a reflective essay over something that they've learned during the semester. And so in this assignment, we're wanting to equip our students with tools and knowledge that we believe will help them later on in their academic careers. And so this is always a fun experience and a fun assignment to teach. We start with we have them do some self-reflection on the semester. Classes give them different prompts. I think the prompt for this one was reflecting on a particular experience that they had this semester. So it has to be something that, this is your first semester at college. Like how's your life different now than it was when you started? And so they're reflecting on that experience. And what's, maybe what's something that's changed for you. In light of, we often, all the classes attend a play, and so we'll pick up on a particular theme from the Cornerstone play and have them build their story around that. And so the story, the idea here is kind of on the idea of journey, of traveling. And so we get those images of her that she's taken, and she's done a good job of integrating and combining, images, her own images of traveling and kind of moving, along with, stock footage or stock images that she's finding, to craft. And we really emphasize the narrative that, so they have to, we do a storyboarding session and do story circles where we're gathering with the students and getting them to share their stories. And then we work with the learning studio, and they come in and do training on the software. And using something like Adobe Spark is a very low bar that allows our students to just pick right in. And there's not any really highly sophisticated things going on in this video. It's from a technological standpoint, it's pretty simple. But she's able to kind of synthesize what resources she has to produce a narrative. And so we see that as something that we hope will provide some reflection on the freshman experience. This is a freshman orientation class, and reflection is part of that that class, but also about equipping them as they go on to take their English classes, where they're going to have to work with narrative and do digital essays, and some of their Bible classes, where that's going to be a component of their education. And then after, where they have this competency of, hey, I can throw together a 2-minute video on whatever topic if needed. So,
thank you. And Ryan, here we have some of the work that you sent.
Yeah. So digital entertainment technology is a completely project-based major. No quizzes, no tests, it's all make stuff. And from the get-go, very first class, the very first assignment is create a lame superhero. For some reason, this really connects with this generation, and I'm not sure why. So right off the bat, and I'm a very big believer in educationally, people aren't going to learn something until they have to learn it. So the very first assignment is they have to create an image, a mock-up of their superhero, which very strict requirements on that. The power superpower has to be useless. And I give them the examples from my own life where the cat lounge man, my cats love to, I seem to be a lounge. That's a superpower. So these are the examples they're given. It has to be done in Photoshop, and they have to create it. So this is an example of one. This is Candyman. Encountered a radioactive pinata. And the only power they have is to be able to throw pink radioactive candy. So that's, this is Danger Boy, or Danger Doyman, has two powers. Everywhere they go, danger befalls them. You know, it's walking down the street, snakes start falling from windows, but they never take any physical harm from this. So it is, again, completely created in Photoshop. If they already know Photoshop, I tell them to use Illustrator. I want them to be learning a new product, expanding their own capabilities, and going from that. So that's their very first assignment. I don't spend a lot of time going over the ins and outs of Photoshop. I expect them to be learning these tools, and with the digital entertainment industry, game design, film, real-time CGI, virtual reality, these fields are changing so often. If they're not willing to try and keep up with the software, they're in the wrong major. I tell them, go be a history major. I love history. I'm fascinated by history. We take a lot of our stuff from history, but it doesn't change as frequently. So there's not quite the pressure to keep up. We have to relearn our field, what, every 18 months?
At least.
And so that's a good year. So we really press them that they've got to keep up with it. So that's their very first assignment. The second semester, I challenge them to do a mashup. They have to take two disparate things, edit them in Premiere Pro, and this is after their first semester where they've been working green screen, special effects, After Effects. They've learned the basics of Premiere Pro. This is to really bring their editing skills and hone them to a really fine point. So this was done by Stephanie Ramirez, who's graduating this year. She's probably one of my top editors right now. But she created this. So.
New details today in the gruesome murders of a local family found earlier this week.
I didn't want to move here.
We couldn't afford to live in the old house anymore. Plus, the new story I'm writing is here.
Is the story a good one this time?
I'm going to write the best book that anybody's ever read. I got a really good feeling about this. You gotta be kidding me. Family here with barbecue session. That's the family who lived here. These are serial murders? I don't know. First one I found dates back to the 60s. The interplay between all these cases is the symbol.
The symbol is associated with a pagan deity named Bagul. He consumes the souls of human children.
We have to leave here now.
See all of them before we premiere them. I like to preview beforehand. It doesn't always happen, but they are given the criteria it needs to be ACU appropriate. Some of them like to push what that, trying to redefine what that is. But yeah, we showed this one and everybody wanted to watch it again. So they were very excited about this, and I've been showing this as the example to the classes of what the standard is ever since she completed this project, and it has definitely raised the quality of the projects that are coming out, and far fewer music videos now that are just so. Those are some of the examples of some of the projects. We've also got, we had our first ever real-time CGI film submitted to Film Fest this year. So we're very excited about that. They did, help me out here. They used Photoshop for texturing as well as substance painter for so that we could get PBR rendering inside the environment done in a very noir environment, and then bringing all of those elements, the full game pipeline, into the Unity game engine to render that. And next year we're going to switch that over to real-time raycasting, mm-hmm. assuming we can get our graphics cards upgraded to do that. It's we've seen a huge shift to being able to do the convergence of game design, real-time CGI, bringing that all together and be able to create entertainment that is really pushing the boundaries. It's a lot of fun. A lot of hours go into it, but the students love what they're doing, and we scare away the ones in the freshman year that aren't willing to make the time commitment to keep up with the hardware and software.
So we're going to move on to a few other questions. Thanks mm-hmm. for sharing this example. So I think that gives us some really great idea of the various ways that it's being used across campus. So let's talk about this one. And you've kind of referenced it some within your examples, but what technology fluency is most important to graduate in your field, and how is ACU providing this?
Well, I'll jump off. We'll go back and forth this way. So, first in, first out. The digital entertainment, just like the art and design, we're very portfolio centric. The students are hired or not hired based upon the quality of their portfolios. In the game industry, in the film industry, it's do you have competency in Photoshop? Do you have competency in Premiere Pro, After Effects? Those are the skill sets they want to see. Do you have industry certification on top of the degree? Is a high expectation for our graduates. If they're going to Hollywood to work in the film industry, they've got to have After Effects. They've got to have Premiere Pro. If they're going to Austin or San Francisco, it's about can you do the game development pipeline, 3D modeling, texturing, and then working inside that game engine. So, the technology is the third name of our degree, so there is an expectation that you will be fluent, and if you're not fluent, you're not getting out of our degree plan.
Thank you.
Ditto, and I've already said, you know, the industry standards in graphic designer, InDesign, Illustrator, and Photoshop, but one of the things that I would always encourage our students to do is have a subfield, whether that's UX or photography or interactive or animation or video editing. If they can stack that onto their graphic design portfolio and show, hey, I have competency in these other things, that makes them a lot more marketable. And I think that $20,000 increase that we've seen in average salaries is directly attributable to those, not just kind of the primary skills they're learning, but also those secondary components. And so, like you guys, we're constantly pushing them to learn new technology. And we kind of push them in a way where it's like, a lot of it is very self-guided. You need to learn this skill. And we've done a lot of work. I say we, and by we, I mean not me, other people in my department, have worked really hard to create a number of technology modules that we're using to train our students on and require them using kind of a competency-based assessment to make sure that they're meeting these skills within it or showing competence in a particular skill set in a certain time frame. And so they come into these lab sessions and they have to perform this skill and they've got 20 minutes to do it. And because you're on the clock when you're in graphic design. And so we a lot of the videos we created ourselves through screen capturing, but we also use other resources like our Lynda subscription and that sort of thing that we can point them out to these other tools. Because we're not just trying to train them to use the equipment, we're trying to train them to learn how to train themselves. because that's the skill set that they need when they're in an industry where those technologies are developing so rapidly.
Yeah, I mean, that's not really a question that I think we think about very much, right? In our department, like what technology fluency do they need to have? So, the way I think about it, they have to be, when we got students that are going into a variety of different programs from our department, but in any of those, whether they're maybe preaching or they're in youth ministry or some other teaching capacity, or they're working for a nonprofit, which is very popular among our students, I think they have to be compelling storytellers, right? And these are tools that help them become better storytellers, I think. And so, if you're And that can come in the form of a video, like you'd be able to create that. So if they end up getting to work for a nonprofit ministry of some kind, they're going to have to be able to tell a compelling story that's going to call other people who want to get involved with the work they're doing when they're out fundraising somewhere. Right? But they can use these kind of skills with fluency. That's going to only empower them to do that better. Or, I mean, even like, you know, if you're preaching somewhere, same kind of thing there. Now your storytelling is going to come in different forms, but I mean, something that I would love for our students to be able to do is design. I haven't done this yet. Maybe I should incorporate this into the assignment. Build design a graphic of some kind that can be the theme graphic for whatever lesson series they're working on. I mean, you know, you're seeing that more and more. Churches have people who are doing just that, or teachers and preachers within the churches are being asked to do that. And so, I mean, those are. But it's all in the service of being good storytellers, I think. But I think that's, yeah.
Just kind of piggyback off. Yeah. Since it's one of my areas of research is church communications, mm-hmm. and so I need to invite you to the church communications Facebook group.
Oh yeah.
Which is like 25,000 people who are at all these churches across the world, and they're just writing in questions or hey, share your April Fool's Day graphics or Easter mm-hmm. graphics. And I can't tell you how many people on there are, hey, I'm a solo preacher at a one-man shop. Where do I go to get bumper videos for a sermon series on Isaiah? You know, and so that's a real life, you know, issue where, you know, our churches are equipped with extensive media production. You know, you have all the way from churches with concert lighting, triple wide screens or LCD panels that are $500,000 to churches that are even equipped with projection slides and they're just wanting some, you know, hey, I need some backgrounds for my sermon series or we're trying to move away from paper bulletins and want to do, you know, just a digital bulletin. And so, these questions are out there and they're being asked, and the more we can equip our students to know that those resources are out there, and I think that's invaluable.
Thank you. As a former minister myself in youth ministry, I was the guy who was designing all of our graphics for the church. And there are a lot of churches and really companies, small businesses who have to rely on, you know, how do we market ourselves? And we have students who are business majors who will maybe start their own companies. How do they do that maybe as they're starting up and kind of understanding that? So we see it across all disciplines. Mm-hmm. You know, we have a very good way, example here, because we are a Christian college, we train a lot of ministers. But I think across the board, it's something that more and more people are needing to know, that skill of creativity. I think it was there was a report that showed that creativity was like the number three essential skill, you know, that employers were looking for. And LinkedIn's newest survey said creativity was the number one soft skill that they want their employees. And that they want them to learn, and they want to be able to train them in that. So we see that not just in a design aspect, but creativity, just overall. You know, how do we solve problems that don't exist right now, or how do we prepare students for jobs that don't exist right now? And y'all talked a lot about the being able to constantly grow with the changing nature of our technology, and that's becoming more and more a part of pretty much any industry. So it's like all of our students really need to be able to grow as things are changing. So thank y'all for those examples. We're gonna, I think y'all covered some of this, you know, some of the driving force on why you're using them, these softwares in your classes. But what are some of the challenges, maybe it was on this one. Yeah, what are some of the challenges that you face in using these in your classes?
Keeping up to date.
Yeah.
It is a challenge as a full-time faculty person. You know, we've got to be creating the best pedagogy that we can possibly create. We've got to stay up to date on what's the trends in our field and write papers, publish. Oh yeah, we need to keep up with the latest version of the software. And with our field, we've got a new version every single year with changes that come in. For us, we are very dependent upon lynda.com and YouTube and using the Adobe tutorials, and it's critical that we, because of the technological changes, we can't be master of everything. The sage on the stage concept isn't going to work, so we have to transfer that to other resources that are already available, and you know, sometimes it's even show a tutorial to the students in the class to make sure everybody's watched it, mm-hmm. not just provide the link to it, but make sure everybody has it if it's an essential skill. So yeah, the biggest challenge is keeping up to date.
The thing I would say that we're constantly combating is attitude and morale. And there are two things that I see students come in with. One is I have a set of students who are just technology averse, and they'll just say, "Oh, you know, I don't like technology doesn't work well with me." Even though, you know, we make a lot of assumptions about the current generation, and we assume that they know how to work computers. They don't know how to work computers. They know how to work phones. Like, that's a very different thing. They don't know how to save anything on a USB drive. That was 10 years ago. Like, they don't know how to organize files. Like, you know, and so they come in with a very limited knowledge base. And because of that, there can be a barrier, especially when you're in a general, you know, freshman class that's not people that have selected into this major, but just, you know, general population, and you're gonna have four or five students that are just gonna have, you know, problems all the way throughout. Kind of keeping their attitudes positive in the midst of those technological problems is one of the issues that I face. And then the other group is the, oh, I'm not creative group. And one of the things that we teach is, and emphasize heavily, is creativity is a skill that can be learned and taught. It is not a trait that you're born with. There are not some people that are just creative because they were born that way. This is an opportunity for us to exercise those creative muscles and develop a new, you know, part of ourselves. And so, I'm constantly trying to tell those students, like technology is, you know, and I'll tell you something, one of the reasons I use Spark, even though it's so simple, is because it's so simple. And they look at it, and I mean, literally the tutorial we have on it is 3 minutes or something. And you walk away and you're like, yeah, I can do something in that. But sure, you know, like that's doable, you know. And then, I kind of provide opportunities for our students that are a little more technologically gifted and interested to use other resources. But I would say just the attitude or morale part is a big struggle.
What are you doing to teach creativity? You said it's a skill that can be taught and can be learned. What are you doing to do that?
So we actually have an entire week that's devoted to creativity. The way that our freshman orientation works, we bring all the freshmen together on Mondays of every week of the semester, and we have kind of rock stars from each of the different departments come in and do a lecture, kind of like a TED Talk. And so we actually have a speaker come in and talk about creativity, and that's one of the major points that he makes, is creativity is a skill, not a trait. And so we talk through growth mindset with them, Carol Dweck's research, and model examples of what that looks like. Then on Wednesdays and Fridays, we come back to the classroom, and we're in groups of 30 or less, usually about 25. And then the teachers kind of extend on the conversations that happened on Monday, along with readings and videos and that sort of thing. And during the creativity week, we have partnered with the Maker Lab, and we do a design challenge where we are specifically having them kind of work through a task, and we talk about iteration, and we talk about rapid prototyping, and we're building the foundations for a design thinking mindset based on IDEO's models, and trying to implant that quickly to kind of give them a base, you know, crash course in design thinking and creativity. So,
let's see here. So, with what y'all done, what are some of the outcomes that you've seen from these assignments? What benefits do students walk away with by learning and using these tools?
Well, I mean, as I mentioned before, I've seen it empower a different set of students than an essay assignment empowers, right? I mean, there's some students that are wired that way and can succeed with an essay, and they might find themselves floundering a little bit by putting together the video, where there's others that's much more their native home, they're comfortable there, and they can excel there. And so I like that offering some different mediums of communication can empower different sets of students. So I found that to be true. And I would say one of the big benefits is, for my students anyway, it requires some vulnerability to kind of put stuff in there and then put themselves out there, not only with the performance we do live, but also put it into the video. And when we make ourselves vulnerable together, then that creates a really meaningful learning community. So I think the community building part of it has been a real nice thing.
We've been real heavy on mixing our upperclassmen with our lower classmen,
mm-hmm.
and to create a knowledge spiral, so that the freshman that's working with a senior sees their final projects and going, oh, how did they do that? And they show them. And so suddenly this freshman has some of the skills that the senior has taken 4 years to produce. And this has been going on now for 10, 11 years. And so every year we're getting higher and higher, stronger products being created as they're going through and continuing to pass that knowledge down. One of the things that we have to watch though for is gaps that can arise as that happens. It's like, oh, everybody knows how to make a great cinematic mashup, but we've forgotten how to shoot a projectile inside the game engine because nobody mentioned that, and everybody assumed everybody else knew that. So it's something that we have to constantly guard against and we're doing that, but the outcomes are because of the advancing in the tools, because of the students sharing that knowledge, the products that are coming out each year continue to get better.
Did I mention salaries? No, I mean, not that it's a lot, but it's just remarkable to me. That's a tangible outcome. But the other thing I would, just piggybacking on Cliff, that community experience when we do the digital essays, we do a screening of everyone's video. We tell them, we're gonna play your video, and there are students, and you're not allowed. I will stand by the door and make sure they don't. They're like, oh, I gotta go to the bathroom, and I'm like, no, sit down. You can go after your video plays. And so we have students, covering their heads as their video is playing. But hey, you gotta show. It's a performance. I tell them like, there's an old theater joke. What do you call a performance to an empty crowd? A rehearsal. Like, performances are made to be experienced by an audience. And so you are going to have to share this because there's a performance aspect to it. And so when they play those, you know, there are the kids that are covering their heads, but the support from everyone else is just so great. Like everyone is cheering, and you see that person like sit up in their chair a little more, you know, like, yeah, I made that. And I love seeing that just that body posture change is so, you know, and we always come out of that experience and are just renewed, and we feel like a tighter knit community, which is one of the goals of the freshman orientation class, is that you have a learning community. And that is such a great like capstone on the end of the Cornerstone experience. So
awesome, thank you. So we just have a couple minutes, so we're just open it real quick. If anybody has any questions, now is a good time.
Can you go back to the first question or so in your spark? I wanted to shoot a photo of it. Keep going.
This or the
no higher the first very first one.
Oh, okay. Would you like me to send this to you?
Sure.
I can share it.
I was intrigued by the notion of the gaps.
Yes.
You know, the notion of like a projectile in the game engine. And what I'm interested in, and I would imagine that you all in your own field have those skills, which if the student doesn't get it, it's a gap.
Yeah.
And kind of another way of putting that would be it's a competency. It's something that they... if they don't have it, whether now or later, it's going to be a deficiency in their professional performance, right? And so my question is the knowledge of those gaps, those competencies, you've been drilling at this, is that explicitly stated in terms of what your students need to learn in their programs? Here are the things that you pass through our programs, technology or otherwise, you know, like the projectile. Or is that implicit within your instruction to where you're looking for that? I'm trying to see where these competencies reside within the knowledge base of the department. Is it something that's surfaced and super at a level that you can look at it, or is it more felt than seen?
I think we have both.
Yeah?
Okay. As with all programs, there are definitely stated competencies that the students have to have as they go through the program. Others are implied. A projectile, we're making a game. You're probably going to have a projectile. You need to know how to launch a projectile.
Right.
It's not something we necessarily give a lot of thought to until a student says, how do I do a projectile?
Yeah.
Oh, well, this is how. Because it's not hard.
Yeah.
But once you have that knowledge, you have it. It's universal.
Yeah.
It takes like 3 minutes to go over it. But it is something that maybe it does need to be more formalized, but then we just start having a list of 10,000 items.
Exactly. Yeah, it's hard. And we try to articulate what are the competencies, digital literacies.
Yeah.
What you said, the context, you realize it's so context specific to what the student's trajectory is, what the faculty's interest is. It's very difficult, but they exist. And to be able to talk about these are really helpful for your narrative, so I'm very grateful.
I picked up on two things that you folks said, and that was for your program with the game design, they have to have a desire to be continually learning because of the continual changes,
yes.
Right? And then you keyed on the fact that they have to actually know how to research and to learn,
mm-hmm.
Right? That's a skill that you want to provide them. Because there is constant change.
Yeah.
So when a competency might be overlooked in that vein, they should have the ability to research that,
exactly.
Right? And then they should have the wherewithal to know that they're gonna have to continually be learning and updating their skill set. Right? So I think that's a valuable soft skill.
Yeah, the thing about your question, John, one of the challenges I see is that the process of changing your learning objectives for a program is arduous.
Mm-hmm.
And so what that pressures departments to do is to try to find the most vanilla objectives that they can so that they can make lots of changes and adapt as quickly as they need to help their students without having to go through the arduous process of changing their objectives every time. So unless we're lighter on our feet in terms of the ability to keep that list updated, you know, we're gonna keep going for bland objectives that then we can in less clear way, less overt ways, you know, kind of keep it updated in a class by class level or something.
I just want to say, I think you're right. We need to know those least common denominator competencies. And I think you just articulated some beautiful ones right there. It's very helpful to understand those higher level skills, which you wouldn't articulate at the department document, especially in terms of academic support. These conversations are helpful to know, okay, hey, there's something which your student doesn't get. And so how do we provide the softwares, even the tutorial softwares, like the Lindas and that sort of thing, you know, to know you're reliant upon those for those higher order skills. I just want to, from my perspective, that's really helpful here, and I just want to advocate for you continuing to say those things, even if they are context specific. It's really, it's very helpful to know that.
Well, thank you all so much for being here and joining us. Thank you all for your participation. I really enjoyed that conversation and being able to learn a lot more about what we're already doing, but I think that gives ideas to maybe other departments on what can be done, and that this isn't just, you know, creativity isn't just for the creatives. You know, it's not just for the art and design or the journalism or the digital entertainment technologies. It's something that we all need, and that's what research is telling us, is that this is something that we all need. And you know, how can we, as those who are supporting these students, foster that creativity within our classroom so that our students can develop those skills? So thank you all for y'all's examples of that, and for your willingness to share that with us. So I think that's all we have for today.
Thank you.